Does your company need a boost getting employees to understand that safety is a personal responsibility? Does your company struggle with recordable injuries and lost time accidents? If that's you, give our friends at Wagner Industrial Training Systems a call today at 717-479-1052. Wagner Industrial Training Systems offers a variety of safety and continuous improvement services, including forklift certification and behavioral-based safety training topics that include lockout, tagout, machine guarding, PPE, respirable crystalline silica, and countless other topics. Does your company require first aid, CPR, or AED training? Wagner Industrial Training Systems has licensed instructors to cover those topics as well. What would life be like for your family if something happened to you today at work? Give the guys at Wagner Industrial Training Systems a call at 717-479-1052. Also, you can check them out at Facebook at Wagner Industrial Training Systems. All of our Going Yard podcast listeners will get 10% off of their first class just by mentioning that you heard this ad. So call today. Hello, everyone, and welcome to our third wildcard episode. This episode, the reason why this is in the middle of the week here is we got a holiday weekend coming up here, and we're kind of doubling up our episodes and cramming them in here just so, we don't let them sit around for a while. We want to make sure we get them out to you guys sooner than later.
Yeah, no, we have a great problem in a way, but we have a lot of great interviews and people who want to be on the podcast and stories we want to get out to you, and we really don't want to make anybody wait. We don't want to make them wait. We don't want to make you wait because it's really good content. It's really good information. We really hope that you take it, that you soak it in, that you share it with your family, your friends, your son, your daughter, the coaches that you work with, and all of that, because it's really, really good information, and we really hope you're going out and checking out some of these Instagram and YouTube pages that we're bringing to you.
Yeah, and we were introduced to this guest that you're going to hear here shortly, Ryan Johansson. We were introduced to him via Taylor Gardner, which was an earlier episode that we had, and it was a nice connection we made here. And this guy has some great stuff to offer just in this interview, but you can go and check out his stuff online. It's so informative, and I think you guys are really going to like it. But hope you enjoy this wild card episode with Ryan Johansson. Enjoy. We are on the line with Coach Ryan Johansson. Ryan played college ball at the University of Pittsburgh-Greensburg. Since college, Ryan has coached college baseball with Aurora University when they were ranked 23rd in the nation and Judson University when they were ranked 16th in the nation. He has coached travel programs such as Top Tier Baseball LLC, which has put over 400 players in college programs across the country. He has also worked with Prep Baseball Report and most recently was a head baseball recruiting coach at the National Collegiate Scouting Association, where he worked with over 1,500 athletes and their families in finding the right fit for college baseball. He is the founder of Johansson Baseball Incorporated and Illinois Lions, a high school faith-based travel team. So, Ryan, we appreciate you coming on. Thanks for coming thanks for hopping on the line.
I appreciate you guys having me. Looking forward to hanging out.
Yeah, it's been a crazy day, man. Just even getting this interview started has been crazy, and I'm fumbling my words, and it's okay. So we're just gonna make this fun.
Oh, absolutely. That's what is gonna make it fun, right? The trial and error, and we don't need the scripted stuff where it's just reading lines. That's for sure.
Exactly.
Hey, Ryan, it's Tyler. Thanks again for joining us. We really appreciate it. We love some of the stuff you've been posting online for a long while, and that's some of the stuff that caught our eye and really wanted us to reach out and connect with you and share what you have to say to our listeners, and hopefully share your knowledge to them who haven't heard of you, which if they haven't, shame on them. So, we're going to dive deep into a lot of the things you've been doing for probably a long while and some of your thoughts and ideas on the game.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I'm glad you guys were reached out, and hopefully we can get a couple more followers out of this. That'd be great.
Yeah, with any luck for everybody, you know what I mean? So I just want you, for those who don't know you, if you can you just go back to your high school days and how you ended up getting to the University of Pittsburgh-Greensburg?
Oh, man, this is going to be going right along with the day. What a terrible question to ask.
Perfect. So
every great story has a terrible beginning.
Right? Yeah, exactly. So I was a junior in high school. I actually started to go to some of those prep baseball report events, and I was not nearly as good as I thought I was at the time, looking back. We played against competition that was trying to hit ground balls at second base, and I was known as like a ground ball pitcher. I didn't have like the high velo or any of that stuff, but I'm going to these PBR showcases where like I'm expected to like throw hard, and I didn't know the difference. Yeah. So thankfully though, I got kind of recruited from some smaller D3 programs around the area in the Midwest, and was really excited about it. My senior year is coming up. And, so I must have at this time kind of fast forward to like spring where it's time to like make a decision. You're starting to get like your housing stuff figured out. And I was actually dating a girl at the time, and she really, really, really wanted to go out east. She grew up in Pennsylvania, and my thought was, you know, I really don't want to go to, like, the same college as my girlfriend. We've been dating for, like, 2 years. Like, you know, I don't want to be, like, 10 hours away. And I was at a showcase and, you know, happened to kind of just, like, email, you know, this guy out and said, like, hey, I saw you guys were there. I don't know if you watched me pitch or not. And he was like, man, we're a commuter college. Like, we don't like get guys like you. You know, so like, I wasn't even going to bother, you know, reaching out or whatnot. And, it was like kind of like a little bit more like halfway between. And, I probably really should have gone to Coe College, and, Coach Cook over there is the man. And, probably would have had a better baseball experience. But, anyways, that's how I ended up at Pitt Greensburg. And the first day I was there, I got picked on. They had a comedy guy coming up, and I'm in like the way back row, and they're like, yeah, who, anybody from out of state? And, like raised my hand. I was the only person in the room who like raised their hand. He goes, what'd you do? Throw a dart at a map? Like, how'd you end up in Greensburg? Like,
we're located.
We broke up a week before moving. So that, you know, added insult to injury, but, it was a good experience. I'm glad I went. So God puts you in the right spot.
Yeah, let me tell you, that was the first and only, I won't go into too much detail, but that was the first and only college I've ever been kicked out of ever in my life, that college.
Really?
Yeah, I got kicked out, and I was only there for 3 hours.
Wow.
We drove up to go meet a friend that went to school there, a friend of mine. It takes about, from Hanover, Pennsylvania, it takes about, it was more than a 3 hour drive. It was a long,
it's probably close to 4 hours.
It was a long drive, and we just couldn't, when we ended up leaving like after dinner, so we didn't get up there until late. We weren't supposed to be in there, and we ended up getting in trouble for drinking in the dorms, and we got kicked out, and weren't allowed to come back anymore. So, yeah, that's so weird that you say that.
Yeah,
I had to bring that up because that school, I tell that story all the time to friends and my wife, and like, listen, this is how my late teens, early 20s, started out getting kicked out of a college that I just showed up at. But
you probably had no clue where you were at.
No. And we ended up having to drive and try to find a hotel somewhere, but to crash at. But that's funny you said that. Now, tell us a little bit about your career there while you were playing.
Oh, man, it was short-lived. I went and went in the fall. Pitched really well in all our inner squads. We went down and we played a team from West Virginia, and it was we just got a new coach, right? So the guy I originally talked to actually got like was asked to resign. I guess he was doing like some weird stuff, and like it came out, and there was like some pictures, and I don't know the
he was hanging out with Dan
on it.
probably
sorry
yeah and but yeah, anyway, so then, we got this guy, he was a cop. So he was a head coach, but his full-time job, he's a detective. He drove this big black van, and, he had like some connections down there. So when we played this team, man, I can't remember the name of it. They're orange. There was like an hour outside of where we were at. maybe hour and a half. And the hardest ball I've ever given up was the very first batter I ever pitched to in college in that fall game. I fell down in a 3-0 count, and I thought to myself, wow, this is like our real like game. So, like, I'm not walking my first like real hitter. Like, it's not going to happen. And I grooved, man, the prettiest fastball to this man. My memory says he's like 8 feet tall and like just massive and like huge human being, but I'm sure it wasn't that big. And he just crushed this ball to dead center. And our center fielder kind of like went back at the wall and like touched the wall. He came like in and like caught it. And I was like, oh no, like I'm never throwing that pitch ever again, ever. went like two curveballs, the next two guys, it was like roll over. They're like, yeah, good inning. And I was like, oh no, like I'm in trouble. Like I cannot just throw, I just only have a curveball. So I worked on some velo stuff, like one of the like last days of fall, like tore up my shoulder. They like wrote an article about it, like back here. And we tried to rehab with some of our summer teams and do some stuff here. And I like just never, I never got any velo back. Any velo I gained, like while going to college and working out, was just like completely gone. So then I actually went back to NIU. I don't have this in my bio. I went back to NIU and I worked with, for like a month, like they let me kind of like a team manager, and I like, you know, worked with their coaches and stuff like that. And that was pretty much the extent of like my college, like playing career. It wasn't like a big long 4-year thing or anything. And, that's kind of why I wish I would have gone somewhere else where I had more support and better rehab and all that other stuff.
Hey, you know, I mean, all roads lead you in a direction for a reason, right? You know what I mean? So transition out of that and into your coaching, you know, how long after that did you realize like, man, like I could really help, you know, these people? And how did you end up getting into coaching, at the couple colleges you were at?
So when I first started coaching, it really was more of I want to stay around baseball. I really like baseball. I feel like I know a lot about the game. I have this like baseball wisdom. Like my dad knew so much about baseball, and I have all these great coaches around me. Like my high school coach played pro ball. I had a Hall of Fame high school coach.
Wow.
For the Illinois, like all this stuff. And I've got all this like great baseball wisdom around me. And like, I like couldn't use it. I like couldn't do anything with it. So I really wanted to get into coaching, and go from there. So when I was at NIU, that was part of like the reason I transferred back like home, because it's like very close to where I live. So I'm not 8 hours away anymore. And those guys were really great. And, I kind of learned like what they did, like at the Division I level, which is very different than anything we did, at Pitt Greensburg. And it was kind of cool. And even that was like, just like baseball wisdom stuff, like old school, like very like old fashioned. Like it made sense to me, like some of the stuff we did at high school. And I was like, man, like, this is it. Like, I know how to do this. Like I can go and like transition from this, like this stuff isn't new to me. And, so I kind of got this like probably like almost like a big head about it, like dang, like I know how to do this, like this is all it is. Like and I went and I started doing like lessons and things of that nature, you know, had some success. And I got into Aurora because I went to being the instructional program director at a place called Home Plate Batting and Pitching, which it was like a new company. Two aunts started it for their nephew. And they were like asking questions like, what's a drop three bat? And I'm like, oh no, we have stock. they have this baseball facility, and their other nephew was running it as well. He's like the manager, and he did a good job, through there. But they needed like somebody to actually run camps and somebody to like do lessons and somebody to actually kind of run the place. And it was brand new and just literally like fell into my lap. It was one of those things, like somebody introduced me to these people and they're like, yep, all right, you're hired. And I was like, oh wow, okay.
Hired for what?
yeah, exactly. Like, you don't have any camps going on yet. So I basically was like designing programs, and I was trying to convince them like, of like, hey, if I were to do this, this is like the model that like I would do. And they more wanted to fall into like the renting space model. So that's kind of like where really Johansson Baseball, like what we do at our place, like began. It was really like in 2012, like 2011-ish, where like this all kind of conceptualized, and we just didn't have the resources or the manpower or the clientele to really do it yet. And so that's kind of where like some of the first ideas like came to be, and they were shut down by this other organization. So, I'm sitting and I'm just on my couch, like 2 in the morning. I'm like, you know what? Like I'm just going to send out a bunch of resumes to all these college coaches and see if anybody bites. And it's like January. So I'm like, hey, does anybody need a volunteer assistant? I like emailed like every D3, like every D1, like every D2 in our area. I probably sent like 15 emails in like early January. Mm-hmm. And nobody else got back to me. And then all of a sudden, like a week later, Aurora gets back to me. They're like, hey, we actually have a pitching coach position open. Our head coach, took an administrative position. Our pitching coach is going to be the head coach. Like, do you want to come in for an interview? I was like, holy cow, like it worked. Like, that's cool. so I went on for a year with them. That was in 2013, and that was at Aurora. And then I started from there. That's how I got hooked up with Top Tier. So then I was like, okay, what am I going to do in the summers? Like, you know, I have like a little bit of like clout. Like I can say I'm a college coach. And that was a paid position instead of a volunteer position, which they were like, yeah, you know, like it's really rare for like first year coaches to be like a paid position. I was like, I'm losing money in gas getting here, but thank you for like at least helping. Like, that was good. That was a really good experience. I started coaching for Top Tier, and at one of my Top Tier tournaments, I got to meet Rich Benjamin, who is like my mentor to this day. Like anybody who like knows me, like knows about Rich, even if they don't know him. And, cause I just talk about him all the time. He's such a positive influence on everything that I do. And I definitely wouldn't be where we're at and what we're doing now without like just how mind-blowingly intelligent he was and his leadership skills and everything I learned from being there. So he basically convinced me that he was this, you know, great person in this, without saying so, in this parking lot meeting where I'm coaching a team and coaching the Top Tier team. And we just started talking in the parking lot rather. And I was like, hey, like, do you need another coach? Like, this is like kind of seems better than where I'm at. And he was like, yeah, just give me a call, da da da. And, you know, we kind of talked and he asked me a bunch of questions in my interview there that I had no idea the answer to. I was like so lost. It was a lost puppy. And he was like, And like, he was just really cool about it and took me under his wing and like, let me volunteer there. He was just such it's hard to explain, but it was a great experience to be there. And then I just couldn't volunteer, you know, another year there. And so that's when we started doing some more stuff and, on our private sector and stuff there. So that's kind of the long version. Hopefully it wasn't too long.
No, you can talk as long as you want, my friend. The one thing I want to ask you, because from a coach and also as a former pitcher, we've talked to a lot of pitchers on this show, whether it's a high school pitcher or, a college or minor league pitcher, even a pro pitcher. The biggest thing we're hearing, and I feel like this is kind of where our new niche is in this industry, is we really learned about the mindset of an individual. Now you said that, you know, the coach that you learned from really taught you a lot about that, probably also taught you a little bit about mindset as well. And I just want to know, because we hear a lot about the mindset of a pitcher is completely, that's like a huge thing for a pitcher, but not only for pitchers, but in baseball in general, your mind, the game is a mental game. So how, as a coach, you know, in the college level or even in the high school level, how do you teach mindset? What are the biggest things that you, what are the building blocks that you start with and where do you go from there?
Yeah, that can be a very deep question.
Get deep,
in terms
man.
Of that, we try to really add as much perspective as possible. So one of the things from just a hitter standpoint for mindset is want to change the way that people think about the game. Everybody's going to tell you baseball is a game of failure. Everybody's going to tell you that you're going to fail 7 times out of 10 and you'll be a Hall of Famer if you go 3 for 10 in the big leagues. That's all the stuff you're constantly going to hear. It doesn't make striking out any less like upsetting. It doesn't make getting a ground ball or shortstop any less upsetting. It doesn't make flying up the warning track like any less upsetting. So for us, like just as an example, we try to break it down into as simple of understanding as possible that make people go like, huh, like, oh. One of those ways is that in order to be a 300 hitter, you probably only need to hit 3 out of 50 pitches really well. And the way that breaks down for us anyways is you're going to get 30 pitches per 10 at-bats, right? You're allotted 30 strikes per 10 at-bats. 3 strikes per at-bat times 10 is 30. you're going to have probably on average C2 balls at the lower levels, probably per at bat at least. You're going to get 50 balls. This is not including the times that you're going to get the three balls and everything else. Just on average, you're probably going to get 20 balls in 2 at bat. Now you're at 50 pitches. That's not including, you know, you go down 0-2 and you take 3 more hacks that are fouled off and then you strike out. And then now all of a sudden you saw 4 extra ones. So now we're looking at, okay, you have 50 pitches. You have to hit 3 of them really hard. And you're probably going to hit like 7 of them really hard, or maybe 4 of them really hard that are all out, like right to somebody. And maybe you'll get lucky 3 times, like, you know, and they're going to be these little flare duck snarts. So for our guys, it's like, hey, if you strike out, like the mindset is I have 27 left, like who cares? Like I'm not looking at each at bat, like I'm looking like per 10. And then every at bat, it really starts over. So if you go 0-1, you're not looking at the next 9 at bats, but every single time you're up there, you're trying to factor in the fact that like stats aren't linear. I don't need to go 3 for every 10. I just need to have that attitude of I'm going to swing hard and I'm going to attack the baseball. And if I miss, it's okay because I have 27 left. So now in my next at bat, when I'm 0-2 and maybe I hit 1 weak grounder to the shortstop and maybe one was a deep fly to right, now I'm not thinking to myself, man, 0-2 today. Like I really got to get a hit this time. It's just whatever. Like I'm just going to keep my same approach. And maybe that ball is like a hard line drive to the middle, or maybe it's a strikeout, or maybe whatever. But at the end of the day, with that mindset, what we found is like guys are way more relaxed. They have way more fun. And they just hit better when they have like a perspective like that. So, we try to do that with every part of the game, and just break it down into like the smallest, like deepest, like understanding. And then the rest of it is like, we don't tell our guys like on the bench, like when the guy strikes out, it's not, hey, it's okay. It's, hey, you're still great here. Like, you know, it's not like, oh, like Johnny, like it's okay. Like pat on the back, like high five, like you're still good. Like you just struck out. Like the kid doesn't want to hear that. I don't care who you are. You don't want to high five after you struck out.
Right.
But you know, you say like, hey dude, like tough break. Like that was either a really good pitch or like, dude, that swing sucked, but like, you're still a really good hitter. Like, you know,
yeah.
So we try to teach like the mindset of like what's real, but also, you know, we're not like, cause now it's not fake. You know, when you can be real with your teammates and you can say like, hey, I don't care that you just struck out. I still think you're a good hitter. I don't care that you just got out. Like, yeah, that individual swing sucked. Like, sure. But like, I still think you're a great hitter. Kind of makes a little bit different attitude of like, just like faking it's okay, so to speak.
Nice.
Now, I know this is one of your big things and I'm hoping you can explain it to us, cause I always like seeing it in a way. And one of your big things is hashtag be different. Can you just let us know what you mean by that and where that kind of came from and how you kind of use that towards the kids that you're working with on a daily basis?
Yeah, absolutely. So that came from running hills with a group of guys a couple years ago. And it was guys were tired and we were trying to really motivate them. And, you know, the quote came out, I said, look, man, like by definition, like not everybody can be above average. You know, like if you want to be better than everybody, you have to do something different. You have to think differently. You have to act differently. So like while you're looking around, like all these guys are huffing and puffing. If you want to be great, like you want to win the hill race and you want to get faster and you want to get stronger, like you can't quit now. Like most of you guys are going to like look around, but like who's the guy that's going to push himself like to the end? Like who wants to win this race right now? It's only going to happen through the will. Like you have to think differently. So that's where it kind of started. And then it kind of evolved into, all right, all these guys are coming in and they're all saying like, they're all blaming their high school coaches and they're all blaming their parents and they're all blaming, you know, their travel ball coaches and they're blaming all these other things, which why they're not hitting or why they're not doing this. And then it kind of turned into, you have to think differently, right? You have to follow a process. You have to do something that works for you. You can't just say like, you know, you can't be the average kid on your high school team because your high school coach gave you bad information. You know, if it's great information, like sure, like use it. But you can't sit there and say like, well, everybody on my team does this. I'm not going to play or I'm not going to perform, you know, because of what my high school coach told me. So, you know, only 1% of people get to play in the big leagues. And obviously we're all seeing like what's going on and how they attack the ball and the kinetic chain and sequencing and all that stuff. But if you're afraid to apply any of that because you're falling into like some average, you know, average coaching style, you know, a guy who says he has 30 years experience, but really it's 1 year of experience lived 30 times.
that's a good way of putting it.
Very true in the world out there. That's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. So you have to be willing to like do something different in there. And to be honest with you, we tell all our guys when they first start, like if you don't agree with something that we do, like challenge us, like allow us to either A, build context and like tell you why we're like being crazy and like why it feels exaggerated or why it, you know, why we want it to be this way. Like give us a chance to explain it. Don't just say okay and be like, because you feel like you have to be coachable and then not do it anywhere else, you know, don't just like, you're not. And us, you know, and that's the difference. Like we don't make your lineup. And then our travel guys too, like we tell them like, look, dude, if you hit a double to wall, I don't care if it was the way I told you to swing. Like that doesn't matter. Like,
I hear you
hitting doubles, like who works for you. So that's kind of like, we really want our guys like engage with us and interact with us and like not be like just coachable and average, so to speak, like over coachable. And I guess that's where the other part of it comes into, where it's, if you're not willing to be different, if you say like, oh, that kid plays over me right now because he does this. And then you go up and do what your high school coach says and you hit a grounder a second every time, like you're not going to play anyways.
You're not building robots.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah. So. I love what you said about the, you know, challenge us. It kind of reminds me of this. I'm going to do a little shout out to Taylor Gardner, who it's kind of the reason why we linked up here. One of the first things I said in our interview when I read his bio was he's the guy that asks way too many questions. And that's what you need to do. You need to ask the questions. And, you know, if it's something that you're being taught that you don't know why, ask the coach. And if the coach doesn't have a good answer, then ask someone else. And I think that's cool that that's an approach that you're taking. And it really, that's awesome, because you kind of, you put yourself in a situation where you've answered all the questions. You already know what questions that people might ask about this. And, you know, if there's a player that doesn't know anything about it and they ask the questions like, hey, why am I doing this? You got the answer. And that's huge for the player. And that's huge for the confidence that they're building in their coach as well.
Yeah, and I think coaches, as a general rule, should just be learn to humble themselves too, and say that like we don't always have the answer. Like you might ask me a question that I'm going to say like, dude, let's find out together. Like let's figure this out. Like what does that mean? Like why? Yeah. Why? And sometimes it's, why would your high school coach say that? And it's like something like, man, I haven't heard that phrase. Like that's not old school. That's something just so different than anything I've ever heard. Like let's talk about it. Like let's figure out like why that concept or why that. You know, process, you know, why he wants to do that. Cause I want to know from a good standpoint or a bad standpoint. And that's why we use all the technology, because there's definitely, you know, things that we're constantly learning and things that we're constantly investing in continuing education in. And, you know, there's, if a kid asks me something that like, I'm just learning, like I'm going to say like, hey, let's learn it together, you know, over, well, I've been doing this and so, you know, like pulling stuff out of thin air because I don't necessarily know it yet.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. And that's awesome. You bring up the technology side of it, and I know you're really big into it. I was hoping this would come up in a way. Is, you know, how much do you think that influences the things you're doing with the kids? I mean, that you're working with. I guess say kids, but I mean, you know, with the athletes you're working with you know, you, whether it's the blast motion or the hit track stuff. How much of that stuff, you know, influences the type of work and the drills that you're doing with those different players on a day to day basis?
Yeah, that's a phenomenal point. And I kind of touched on it very briefly, and I posted up 60 seconds, you know, on the Instagram post today. But, you know, it's the approach hasn't changed ever since I met Rich at Judson, and ever since, you know, kind of the light bulb came off. And I mean, the very first piece of technology I ever bought was a Stalker radar gun. And that was in 2013 in the fall. And everybody thought I was insane. They were like, why are you spending $500 on this gun? You know, like all my coaching buddies who were, you know, at the same time, like, you know, we're doing lessons for beer money. Like none of us have lives yet. And, you know, on that aspect, they're like, why'd you just spend $500 on a radar gun? And I was like, you know, why not? Like you have like exit velocity is going to be huge. Like you, and they're like bat speed. And I was like, no, exit velocity. They're like, what's exit velocity? And, kind of getting in on that. And it was a huge influence on, okay, like we need to swing harder, like constantly harder. Like this number needs to constantly go up. Like this is an accountability for me and it's accountability for you. And how can we make this process like get better, you know, like from there. But other than that, since I met Rich, really the approach has changed. You know, even before hit tracks, we're trying to hit the top of the cage. You know, we're trying to swing really hard. We're trying to put balls over the fence. You know, we're thinking extra base hits. We're thinking doing damage. You know, that really eye opened me into the constant research ever since I met him. You know, it's kind of really where that all began. And now in terms of Blast Motion and Hit Track, what we're able to do now is a little bit different than before we had the technologies. We can alter each individual player. We can say, you know, you're really good at this aspect. You're really good at hitting line drives, but like your exit velocity is like not going up as much. And we can look at the bat speed and we can say, you really haven't improved your bat speed. So, you know, it's great that we've made you a really consistent hitter, but now we have to do some things and put you in different environments to like constantly make that go up. Or vice versa. You know, we can't tell a kid that can't tell a high school or a college kid who's, you know, 83 to 85 exit velo to constantly hit the ball at 35 degrees. Like those are just outs. So we can kind of basically create hitters to what they're capable of based on the timetable that they give us. If they say, hey, I'm going to be here for 3 months, we can set specific goals. If they say, hey, I'm going to be here until I can hit homers, like that's a little bit different. So,
yeah.
You know, we can kind of map our coaching to their timetable, their budget, and how much work they really want to put in.
You know what I think is kind of cool now about, you know, you talk about buying a radar gun and all these things. It's awesome. And I think what this stuff has allowed coaches that are in the world of doing these things is, you know, when you run track, there's a stopwatch that starts and stops, and there's a certain number that you're trying to beat every single time. And now with all these advanced metrics, there's true numbers that you can kind of put up on the, you know, on the screen. And you know, there's true, and these other things, you can track launch angle, you can track distance, you can track all these things. And now just hitting off, you know, in the cage, doing front toss and all that, it really truly has a purpose. And kids can really start to see the improvement as opposed to, oh, well, you just drove it to the back of the cage. Big deal. I've done that 100 times. But now you can really start to see the exit velocity coming off. You can see the launch angle that a true batting cage doesn't always give you the perception of how well you actually hit a ball. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, I 100% agree. I mean, there's times where the ball hit the L screen that's, you know, 20 feet away, and it looks like a great ball, and all of a sudden, you know, like we look up at the hit track screen, we're like, oh, never mind. Like, you know, like,
yeah.
Like that made me jump and startled me, and it made a loud noise off the pipe, but like, it wasn't really that good of a ball. Whereas like, you know, and it's funny too, because like if parents ever watch or other kids are like, yeah, good ball. And then we all look up and we're like, oh, like our eyes would lie to us, you know? And then there's sometimes too, where like a kid's like, dang, like, I hit that off the end of the bat, and I'm like, it still went like 91 miles an hour to the gap. Like, that's a good ball.
And how do kids respond? How do kids respond to that when they see it, Ryan?
To the negative or the positive, or either one.
I mean, both. Just, you know, let us know about both, honestly. I mean, because a lot of people probably have, that was listening to this, probably have never had their kids go through one of these types of, you know, machines and the data they can get from it.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's a sigh of relief when they hit one off the end of the bat and it's still really hard. And I think it's almost like a sign of frustration when they are like surprised when they hit one really well. Mm-hmm. They're kind of like, oh, like, you know, and we're like, hey, well, you just gotta, you know, here are the adjustments that you're gonna make and try it this way this time. And then, you know, they'll get that better number, and then now they're settled in and they feel better and they feel like they accomplished something. So I think that's the biggest thing too, is like they can leave here every day with a sense of accomplishment. Like depending on what we're working on, they know like they had a good day or a bad day. It's not just like me saying, patting them on the back and saying, you know, thanks for your money. And, you know, we picked something random to work on because you wanted a 30-minute lesson. Like it's, hey, we did our structured program, we did our weighted bats, we did our mobility program. Like, you know, you got better. The metrics are here. Like we're going to save this session. You're going to know like whether it goes up or down, you know, every single time. So it's just always a sense of accountability.
And on that note, since we're talking about that, I'm on your webpage right now, johansenbaseball.com, and I'm looking on there. You have a drill library on there, which is in-facility hitting program, and it looks like it's a 13-week program, and you have it broken down into – you can actually download the calendar for anybody who's listening on all the different drills you can do. And – I would like you to speak a little bit about that and what you offer for the person from that's just coming in and listening, what you offer with that, with the drill library. I see it goes a step further even into hitting power as well, which, you know, especially these days when that's all we're hearing about, you know, we've talked about today with velocity and, you know, with backspin and all that stuff. You know, can you tell us a little bit about those programs that you have?
Yeah, absolutely. so basically what we've done is we're constantly changing those as well. They're not just, you know, something that depends on when you download it and what, you know, version you have. It's totally updated. And, mm-hmm. It's broken down into a couple different days. So the biggest day that if you're looking at the calendar is our velo day. And that's kind of like it's a similar concept to driveline pull down in the sense of everything we do, we're going to do 100% max effort. We're literally going to try to train the central nervous system to move as quickly and as aggressively as possible. And then we have another day on there, proprioception A and proprioception B, which are essentially our body awareness days. So we do some weird stuff and we do some different visual and physical constraint drills where we're putting the body in weird positions where they have to start and stop from. That's kind of our slower day where we're really working on, you know, mechanics, for lack of a better term. Really, most of our programs are designed around concepts and patterns rather than like specific mechanics, just because everybody's different. But those are kind of our days for that. And then we have our BP live day, which is basically just our compete day. We play a lot of quality hit games with hit tracks on there. That's where it's just more relaxed. They come in, like, now it's like, okay, is it working? Like, we're just going to only train, like, or only hit rather. Mm-hmm. Or it's like just flips, batting practice, and then we get to do the hack attack and play the quality hit game. The other day we have on there is our adjustability day. That day is a day where we're constantly changing timing. We're constantly doing a variety of different drills to, again, kind of start and stop in different spots. But it's different from the proprioception days in the sense of it's a lot more like moving. So we want to be moving forward from a different spot or moving backwards from a different spot and then having to get to the same position that we want to get to hit a baseball hard. So that's kind of where it's all broken down. We kind of built a calendar around it. It's a really intensive programming. It's 6 days a week. So it's really good for like high schools if they could actually, you know, if they were actually interested in it and, you know, you combine it with blast sensors and things like that. You know, a college program could take that with the time they have. The way that we use it in our facility is, you know, we'll see guys anywhere from, you know, 3-4 days a week tops. We have a couple guys that come in a little bit more than that. But, you know, for the average family, anywhere from, you know, 10 to 18, even a high school kid, that's pretty much what we're seeing is 3-4 days a week tops. And then from there, each kid will kind of adapt this program to what we feel, you know, their evaluation was. We do all mobility and strength evaluations with our strength coach here before they even start hitting. So we're going to have kind of an idea of, is this guy, you know, going to be strong enough, or, you know, is he going to be able to put his body in some of these positions we might ask him to? We kind of map mechanics a little bit to, you know, what he's actually able to do with his body. And then if they choose to do so, our trainer can work on some deficiencies with them. So that's kind of where those programs are. You know, we don't have every single drill up on our drill library yet for that program. But, you know, if anybody were to ask or wanted to do it, you know, we would definitely help them out and make sure they got the content for what they needed there. And all our guys can load it up on their phone and they know what they all are. So it's nice for them to be able to come in and, you know, say, hey, today's an adjustability day for me, and kind of click it. And, you know, they might know like what drills are traded for what for their specific program.
Yeah. I know you said you may not have everything up there, but it's pretty impressive. And it's very, very detailed, breaks down the entire day. So I thought that was pretty neat. I wanted to definitely have you talk about that. So I appreciate you giving some detail on that.
Yeah, thanks. That was a really cool project for it. I'm glad it came up.
Yeah, no. And another thing, just to build off of that a little bit, and I know you post a lot of stuff about hitting and all these different metrics and variables, but can you just explain for our listeners some of like the throwing program stuff that you do? You have like the Velo Nation throwing program or whatever, then how long that lasts and what that entails and, you know, the information that people can take from it. Because from what I saw and some of the stuff you've talked about and done with it, it seems pretty impressive to me.
Yeah, it's probably one of our strongest programs, you know, into that in terms of like quality. I think the biggest thing that, you know, kind of makes it not one of our most popular programs is the fact that like people come in and they want like pitching lessons. They want to come in for 30 minutes. They really don't know about what it is. And it's tough for us to explain to every single person that walks in the door that's so used to the lesson structure, right? They're so used to like, oh, little Johnny goes and sees this guru and he's going to go make him better. And, you know, then there's no measurements there. It's just kind of random stuff. Like this week we're going to work on like your leg getting a little higher. This week we're going to work on this week. Okay. And now I see this and like, we're going to change it. And it's, you know, there's no rhyme to the madness, so to speak. So for us, it's very similar. We kind of actually created our hitting program kind of around the throwing program, which we got from Driveline. So You know, Driveline, we have the Hacking the Kinetic Chain book, spent a ton of time digging through that. That's a phenomenal read. You know, there's definitely a lot of like review stuff in there because they break it down so well for like anybody, like any dad who wants to like help their kid with pitching. And I would advise them if they want to do it at home, like, or pay the $500 for that book and get some file balls and just dive in and do it, or punt it to somebody like us, you know, for that. And, you know, our strength coaches read it, you know, everybody in our facilities, you know, looked at it. We have staff meetings about it, you know, talked to the, you know, to Mike over at Driveline. He's provided a tremendous amount of insight. Alan Yeager, you know, for their year long throwing program, we punt to that too. You know, and from there now it's a matter of, okay, what does this kid need and how can we implement those programs into how often we're going to see this kid, and how, you know, what their physical ability is. You know, it doesn't make sense for a guy who, you know, doesn't have his legs underneath him or just isn't a physical strong kid in general to all of a sudden say like, hey, all of a sudden these weighted balls are going to help you become, you know, a 90 mile an hour arm. Like, let's build a structure first. And, you know, they kind of touch on that in their book too.
Yeah. The one thing I wanted to also touch on, and I touched on the last interview we did, with on Sunday, we ended up talking a lot about health, nutrition, and things like that. Strength and nutrition, that's a huge part of it. And you had talked, you just touched a little bit on that. Can you kind of tie those two in together and just let us know and let our listeners know the importance of first your nutrition and then your strength on top of that, and how those tie in together? I made a comment in the last episode that, you know, people try to outwork a bad diet and it just doesn't ever seem to work. And when you're trying to do something that's, you know, physically demanding, like playing a sport, if you're not taking care of yourself, you're not, you know, getting stronger, you're falling behind. So I just kind of want to get your mindset on that and your thought process. You can tell us a little bit about what you guys do to set that up, set your athletes up for success.
Yeah, that's a huge thing for us right now, especially in the screen time era. Way less kids are playing outside and riding their bikes, which leads to, you know, way less kids in monkey bars and playing in the playground. So we're looking at way weaker backs than we have in the past, you know, tighter hips than we've ever seen overall. And, you know, that makes it hard to be a really good athlete and move functionally well. So in that regard, that's something that we're really trying to attack. And, you know, it comes down to budgets for families. And I wish there were better options. But if they have to choose between a hitting lesson or group sessions or strength conditioning, you know, we might recommend saying like, hey, like take a break from hitting and just be a better athlete and then come back and see us, or do both right now. And they still would rather just have their son hit or their daughter just hit. And it's kind of like one of those things where, you know, we almost have to take it as a business, but there's a lot of times we're just getting in the weight room and just working with a good, you know, strength coach and making sure that you actually have mobility testing. It's not just, you're not just in a group session with a bunch of guys that you go to two times a week. And it's like, okay, today we're going to do box jumps and tomorrow we're going to do med ball throws and this, that, and it's just like kind of random again. Mm-hmm. But if you have somebody that says, hey, you know, your range of motion, your ankles, you know, your hip strength as you move out here, your thoracic mobility is X. And again, it's got to go back to the metrics, you know, at least for us, where we have a measurable standard of how the improvement through there. And the nutrition side of it's huge because, you know, you put in all this time in the weight room and you do your deadlifts and you do your squats or you do your box jumps or whatever, and your ATP is just cached and your glycogen levels are low. And then you go out and you don't recover. You don't eat anything for 3 hours. Like, your body can't recover. You know, it's kind of like a car. You take out the gasoline and you have to put more in. And then, you know, mass moves objects. So calories are really big. And my biggest thing is parents tell me this all the time, like, you need to eat more. And they're like, oh, he eats a lot. I said, a lot is not always enough. Like, this is a science. Like, there's a caloric intake that will make your kid gain weight. I promise you, you know, you just have to find out what that is. So, again, it just comes down to the couple percent of you, the small percentage of people that say, hey, I want the full solution. The people that say, you know, I'm going to gamble my future on just focusing on this over one another. And, you know, it doesn't have to be anything crazy. If you just eat right, you don't necessarily need all the supplements, but slamming a protein shake or a post recovery shake with some extra carbs in it after your workout in 30 minutes, like, that doesn't hurt either.
Now, how do you balance, because you've brought it up a few times about parents this and parents that, and, you know, obviously at the end of the day, most student athletes or, you know, are doing what they can based on their parents' schedule, their parents' money, you know, and things like that. How do you balance, you know, because everybody who's ever done any type of lesson has ran into that, you know, dad who knows it all, who wants to jump in the middle of it, a parent who, you know, thinks they know more than you and, you know, it's your fault that you did this. How do you manage that with the things that you're doing with some of the people you're working with?
You know, we're still trying to figure that out, in terms of, you know, what the best way to go about it is. And we're kind of in the point where we have some families that want our opinion on what they need, right? Like, can we sell them something that they need, or, are we going to sell them something that they want? Right. So they might come in and want something else, and we might have the ability to say like, hey, really, like I don't agree. Like, I don't think that that's going to be your best bet. I think you should do this program instead. And they're receptive to that. And then there's some families that are like, nope, I only want this. And we're like, okay, well, we have two options. We can turn you away, or we can help you out with what you think you need and maybe transition you in the future. And we kind of default to that second one where, we don't really want to turn families away. We can kind of, you know, incorporate some of the programs and some of the things we want to do with them, you know, while they're here for what they want. And then they kind of see the process and they kind of see, well, how come that kid's doing this much better than mine? You know, when you said you could help him out this much, and I have to say, well, he's on that program that I recommended to you and that you want to do this instead. And they say, okay, well, how do we switch? And then that's kind of where, you know, we're kind of at right now.
It's such a tricky balance. I mean, and, you know, I'm sure you've dealt with it for a long while with doing the travel coaching and stuff like that. So it's always interesting to hear how some people deal with it, because some coaches out there don't really know how to deal with it. Some coaches like, I'm not dealing with the parents, or they don't have a good relationship with the parents, or the stuff like that. So it's always interesting for me to hear how other people, you know, deal with that situation, because it comes up, you know, no matter how good you are at doing what you're doing, it's going to come up.
Yeah, definitely. And one of the things that we just did that was a little bit different, that I actually got yelled at the other day in our facility by a dad, you know, who was really upset about it. And we had a policy where we would allow parents that were back to a private lesson to come back and hang out and say, like, hey, we really want to see you 30 minutes a week. We want you really involved. We want you to go in the basement, outside of other fields, in the garage, at your team practice, wherever you're helping your son out. You know, we want you to be able to implement what we're doing here and show you and talk and interact with you. And then we have our group sessions, which are 90 minutes long. We have, you know, anywhere from, you know, six kids in here at a time, sometimes even more if we have teams or something like that, or other kids from other groups and doing different things. We can't have 30 parents back in our facility. Like, it just wouldn't work. We don't have any place for them to sit, but we have a nice lobby with a lot of couches and Wi-Fi and air conditioning, and, you know, that's where they should be. So we recently changed our policy because we had some problems where people like couldn't distinguish the two. They would sign up for our group sessions and our private lessons. And we were like, hey, like, this is a group session. Like, our rules specifically state with this big giant sign on our door. I was like, oh yeah, no, I get it. And then you just, you know, walking back around and doing a variety of different things. And, you know, so it's one of those things where now it's unfair for us to ask some parents to come back and some parents to stay in the lobby based on what program you're in. And so we just decided to say, hey, you know what, this, our environment and our culture needs to be for players by players. And they really create the culture, not us coaches. Like, we're there to provide information, but they're back there like grinding, like they pick the music, you know, they're just doing the program and they're cheering each other on and it's competitive for them. We really don't need the parents back there. So, now we have just no parents in the training zone policy. And you know, it's kind of recent for us. We've gotten some kickback, but I think overall, if we lose any families or you don't really, if that's the reason why they're not coming to us, I think we're going to gain a bunch of, yeah, of families who say, man, I love that culture. Like, I love the fact that, like, I don't have to be back there. I love the fact that, like, it's just going to be my kids coaching. So it'll be a wash, and you can't please everybody, but the players are stoked about it. Every player we talk to is like, yes, like,
take the pressure,
like, finally.
Off. Yeah.
So, yeah.
There's no pressure pressure from mom and dad.
Yeah. And if we're here for them, then that has to be like the number one thing. And if their parents don't sign them up for it anymore, then, I mean, that stinks, because we're still getting results and it's all measured and we're held accountable whether they're back there or not through the numbers. So that's kind of one thing that we did. But yeah, man, parents, it's so hard, and every situation is different. Every parent's different, and not every dad is a jerk, and not every mom is overbearing. And you know, it's, there's such a wide variety of parent attitudes, and You know, you can't put every single one of them into the same category. You know, you can't generalize them, because otherwise you're going to end up treating someone who's really cool and really nice badly. Or, you know, you're going to be in a situation where, you know, you're going to be really surprised with somebody who's, you know, treats you like a jerk.
Yeah. Now, Ryan, I really wanted to ask you this question, since you're talking about this, you're talking about the kid athlete, or, you know, a high school athlete, and you're dealing with them on a daily basis. And you also work with the National Collegiate Scouting Association. I think this is always an important question to ask, especially with someone who does what you do. What is it that you see from most kids that come into your organization to get help? What is that one thing you see most that they're lacking? Just for the listener that would like to know how to get to the next level, because that's really what our podcast is all about in terms of the interview. It's about getting to that next level. And I'd love to hear your input on that.
I think it's a clear vision for really what they want to do with the game. I think so many times they're trying to please their coach that they have, whether it's their high school coach, a lot of times too, even their college coach. You know, they're so caught up in like, well, my college coach says this. And we kind of talked a little bit about kids being overcoachable, and they really don't have it as, I want to go here with my game. This is my number one goal. I'm going to absorb information and do whatever I can to get here. It's kind of almost like they're almost scooting their way through based on what each coach is telling them. And they don't have a clear vision because they don't know what the difference is. They're, you know, they think that the coach that they're talking to is going to give them the keys to the castle, and that might not be the case. And so they're really confused and unconfident because maybe what they're trying and what they're doing, what they're working hard at, isn't working. And they really just, you know, there's so many times that I'll ask, like, hey, who wants to play professional baseball to a 10-year-old? And it's a group of 10-year-olds. And the first thing they do is turn around and look at each other. And it's like, why are you looking at your guy to your left? Like, it's a yes or no question. You know, like, what do you want? Do you want to play Major League Baseball? And I think a lot of it stems from the parents, to be honest, going back to the parents, because they even, like, they say in front of their kids, like, I know he's not going to be a big leaguer. Like, he's 10. You don't know that. Like, there's a 1% chance, but, like, you don't know if he's going to be in that 1%. Like, why put that in his head? And I think that's what makes, like, facilities like ours so unique. And I actually talked to Taylor earlier today, and we kind of talked about the same thing, because he's in the same boat when they do training or anything else, and they get to hang out with entrepreneurs, like, every day. Like, they get to see, like, how we take risks and how we have, like, a clear driven, like, focus. And, like, it's such a strong parallel from entrepreneurship to baseball, and the guys who are successful in both have a really clear, strong vision for where they want to go. They write their goals down. They understand it's not just like, oh, well, I'll play college baseball if I'm good enough. You know, as a freshman, they're saying, like, yeah, like, what's the next step? You know, like, okay, I'm going to have a list of 25 schools. Like, I can't really talk to them yet, but I can research them. I can know everything I have to know about them. You know, I can have all my different divisions lined up. I can know what region I want to go in. I can know literally what the weather's going to be like and who has turf fields and who, you know, all these other different things. So now the research process is taken care of. And then as a sophomore, you start getting into, like, okay, like, you're looking around and you're looking at your metrics and you're seeing, like, okay, it's getting close. Like, I have, like, a year or two left to, like, really figure this out. Am I good enough? Like, you know, what do I need to do to get good enough, you know, to do that? And then the junior year, you're looking around and you're saying, okay, I really want to play college baseball. I can't go to TCU. I can't go to Vanderbilt. Like, it's not going to happen. Like, I don't throw hard enough. I don't hit hard enough. Like, my dad didn't hit puberty till he was a sophomore in college. Like, you know, I'm a late bloomer, you know, through there. So maybe JUCO might be a good option, or like an NAI school, or, you know, somewhere I can, you know, maybe even D3, like, you know, whatever it is. Like, I think D3, I think every option is such a great option because it's college baseball. It's not, I want to go D1, I want to go D3. So I want to play college baseball, and you figure out the right fit. And so I just kind of, that's what I think the biggest thing is there's not a clear understanding of what they want to go. They kind of want life to happen to them. They don't want to create what they want to do.
Yeah, I mean, it's almost like some of them are just like lost puppy dogs without a clue. And you know, I think it's important, like you say, to have that goal, to have that vision, and, you know, not just one week at a time, but that long-term tunnel vision, because that's what's going to keep getting you back to the batting cage. That's what's going to get you back in the weight room. That's what's going to make you stay after practice and take an extra bucket of fly balls or ground balls, or throw an extra bullpen session when you don't think you need it. You know what I mean? I think it's really important for kids to realize that, you know, goals are obtainable if you put into work.
Yeah, absolutely. And that was a way better way to put it in a shorter amount of time than I did. That was good.
I don't know about that. No, I couldn't help but not bring this up in the podcast. And before we get done and wrap up with you, your big thing, not your big thing, but I know one of your lines here is hashtag faith, family, and baseball. Can you just let us in a little bit in that, you know, area of your life and how important that is to you and what you're doing with the kids you're working with?
Yeah, that's, you know, that's an ever-changing and ever-molding, you know, relationship, you know, with me. And, you know, I'm a Christian, so, you know, myself and God. And one of these things that kind of makes it really easy for me to spend 12 hours here and to build crazy plyo walls and to slice my finger open doing weird projects and, you know, invest everything I have and all this technology and really try to make it work is because I really feel like God has put me through specific experiences to kind of be where I'm at. And part of that was my shoulder injury. And part of that was, you know, going 8 hours away and having some independence and learning, kind of finding myself a little bit and, you know, leading me to the different opportunities I've had to learn the game and to kind of change some of the things I've thought about the game. You know, it's never ending. There's always opportunities. There's always people that, you know, come into my life that I don't really know at the time, but kind of, you know, shape where the future is going to go. So, it's really easy for me to come here at 10 o'clock at night, you know, and do a lesson for a guy or to have a program set up for somebody who that's their only time they can get in that week and they have a tryout versus saying like, hey, it's 10 o'clock. Like, I'm sorry. Like, I'm with my wife right now. And you know, she's super supportive. You know, I wouldn't be able to do anything that I do without her, you know, at all. So that's kind of where the family side comes into play. I have a 1-year-old daughter too, that, you know, we make weird time to see each other. It's not like the traditional, you know, I have breakfast in the morning and then I'm gone 9 to 5. And then, you know, we have our nighttime stuff. Like we do a lot of, stuff early in the morning and, you know, I'll come back to lunch and, you know, we try to make time as much as we can, but you know, that's kind of where the faith and family side comes. My family's so supportive. They're so important to me. You know, I do everything I do because of, I feel like the gift that I've been given and the opportunities I've been given, you know, through God. And then obviously baseball is, you know, it all kind of ties together. I feel like, you know, God put me into baseball and wants me to keep doing it. And, you know, my family, huge baseball family, my wife played Division I softball as well. Like she gets it. She's supportive and baseball's what I do for a living, what I love. And kind of all ties full circle.
So your daughter is going to be a monster, is what you're saying.
she's going to be able to hit that ball. That's for sure.
I'm really excited for her. We have a 7-year-old too, and you know, he's figuring out his swing a little bit, and we're really trying to. He hits actually with my take. We'll call it hitting lessons. It's more hanging out and swinging a bat around a little bit because he's 7. But I don't sit around and watch. Like I don't like all it is like. It, like I won't help him unless he comes and asks, and you know, awesome. I'll ask him sometimes, hey, like, do you want to go hit? And he'll be like, oh yeah, like, let's go. And then like, but like when I'm feeding him, like nothing, not a word, just dude, you're awesome. Like love watching you play. Like, oh cool. Like you hit a double on hit tracks, like, you know, like whatever. and then when he does his time with my business partner, Nate, like he does his time in there and I'm like, dude, that was awesome. That was cool. Like, did you have fun? Did you learn something? He's like, yeah. And I'm like, all right, like let's ride. Like, that was worth it then. I'm like, good job. You know, my wife, so that's kind of how we coach him, and you know, hopefully we'll do the same thing with you know, our daughter. And you know, obviously as they get older, they're going to kind of realize hopefully that like they've have this massive, you know, facility, and not massive, but all this crazy technology and all the stuff they literally have unlimited access to, and they're going to want to hopefully, you know, get to be 13-14 and basically live here with me. So that'll be cool.
I'm sure. I mean, it's just like anything. If that's the environment you grew up in, it's kind of just stays in your blood. So, just whether it's sports or music, whatever it is, it kind of all ties together, as long as you're around it. So that's awesome, man. For our listeners who want to find you online or on social media, which I encourage everyone to check your stuff out because it's very, very interesting. It's so informative. Where can they find you?
Instagram's a great place to find me. My at Johansson_baseball, Johansson with an EN. That account is probably my most active account. I have a personal account as well. That's at @coach_RyanJohansson. And then, online, www.johansonbaseball.com. We have a contact us form. Our phone number's on there, and I encourage anybody to just give me a call or shoot me an email. I can't tell you how many, you know, video analysis, you know, for free that people just send me emails and I'll just send them back. And, you know, sometimes we'll get responses back and sometimes we won't, but, you know, it's just, if you guys need help and we have the time, and it's something that, you know, we can do. Like I mentioned before, I feel like it's obviously my passion, but kind of my duty as well. And would love to help anybody out.
That's awesome. I encourage everyone to come check it out, honestly, because there's some really, really great info, and go back through it and, you know, don't just browse over it. Actually click on some of the videos and some of the stuff, because you'll be very informed from it, honestly. It was, before we get done here, is there anything else you wanted to bring up that we might not have, that, you know, is passionate to you, that you think is, man, I got to let somebody know about this, because I've been, you know, thinking about it forever? Is there anything you wanted to bring up and talk about real quick?
Yeah, probably just one thing. We have a lot of people that say, I don't really like this, it's uncomfortable, but my dad told me to do it, or my mom told me to do it. And as much as some parents won't like to hear this, you don't always have to listen to your parents. They do it out of love. They want to help you. They're not out there trying to ruin your career. So it's not use of, you know, fighting over it. I'm sure anybody who's played the game as a parent or a player, I know that my dad and I definitely got in some screaming matches over baseball, which is silly, you know, looking back at it. But it's one of those things where don't let it ruin the game. Don't let it ruin your passion. Don't let it ruin whatever it is. And, you know, your parents love you, and don't have screaming matches. Just don't do it. You don't want to do it. Let it happen on your own. And one of you guys is going to be right.
That's right.
The way that he wants you to do it, or she wants you to do it, might be the right way. And the way you want to do it might be the right way. And the only way to find out is to just go, and you got to live your life and not kind of live in your parents' footsteps. So, and that can be outside of just baseball and softball. It can be anything. You know, your parents might tell you not to go to that college. The parents might tell you not to go here, not to take that job. And like, if you feel like it's the right thing to do, like, sometimes you got to make your own mistakes, and there's plenty of times that you look back and say, like, man, I really wish I would have listened to my parents. Like, shoot. And there's going to be some times that you're like, man, I'm really glad I didn't.
That's great. That's great, Ryan. Well, we appreciate you coming on the show today. We got a wealth of knowledge. I love it. And we encourage everyone to check out your social media and your website. The question I want to ask you is a question we ask every person that we have on our show. And since you were a pitcher, I'm going to ask it in this way. If you had one appearance in a major league game, what would your walkout song to the mound be?
It would be me facing Bryce Harper, obviously, coming in to try to get one out. It would be click, click, boom, because he would hit the ball so far.
I would intentionally walk him.
Yeah.
Don't even need to throw him four pitches anymore.
Yeah.
I see. Right? Yeah.
I would probably try to intentionally walk him and then throw it at him by accident, and then he'd charge the mound, and I have to deal with that.
He'd throw a helmet at him.
That's awesome, man.
He's been doing Domingo Ayala's weighted helmet program, too, so he's ready to go for 2018.
That's hilarious.
That's great, man. Well, we appreciate you coming on, and we hope to talk to you soon and maybe meet you in person.
I would love that. You guys were awesome. Thanks for the call, and thanks for including me in what you guys are doing. Super cool stuff.
Hey, thanks a lot, man. Really, really love what you're doing. Keep up the great work. We'll be staying in touch with you for sure. We'll be following along with everything that you're doing and spreading the word to everybody that we can. So thanks a lot. Really, really appreciate it. Wishing nothing but the best.
You as well. Thanks, man.
See you. All right, I hope you guys enjoyed that interview. As always, find us on all things social media at Going Yard Podcast and on Twitter at Going Yard and the number 2.
Yes, please do that. Also, on all of those pages, you can find us, find our links to iTunes, which is very important. If you can, please subscribe to us there so you can get all of our episodes as they come out. Leave us a 5-star review. You can also find us on SoundCloud. Google Play and on our webpage at Podbean, which also has all of our content, plus some videos, pictures, and other stuff on there. So make sure you check it all out. It's everything there that we do every week.
That's right. So I think that's a wrap, my friend. So for Ryan Johansson, I'm Dan.
And I'm Tyler. See ya.
Later.